Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another Azure Thursday, the December edition. Tonight, me, myself, and Luc, we will be your hosts for the show. And well, let me start by saying at first, we had plans to host this show physically at the Wortel office in Gouda, but unfortunately, due to the COVID regulations, we were not able to host it there. So yeah, we have to host this meetup once again online.
Change of plans.
Yeah, change of plans. But you know, it will still be a great show, I'm sure. There will still be a small part of the Wortel footprint in this event because the first two speakers will be broadcasting live from the studio in Gouda. So yeah, I guess it's time to bring them in. Yeah. Ah, so that works. Hi.
Hello.
Hello. Hi, Arun. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm great. Thanks. So are you alone or is Johnny also there?
Oh, Johnny's also there, but yeah, there he is.
Hi, good evening.
How are you guys?
Doing awesome. And you?
Yeah, I'm great. Thanks.
I'm fine. Yeah.
So nice. We're looking forward to your session. But maybe we can do a little bit of small talk before that, because, you know, Johnny, I noticed on the LinkedIn page, you call yourself the Cousteau King.
Yes, that's
correct. How did you come up with that name?
It's based on the Cousteau language, the Cousteau query language. And that's the main language in the Azure cloud. So you can use it in Sentinel and in the Defender products and also in the Exchange backend and also in your e-discovery. So it's a large language which you can use to process large amounts of data, and also it's a read-only language, so it's quite fast.
Yeah, and you call yourself the king because you're really proficient at it, or?
Yeah, it's I do it a lot of hours a day.
Ah.
And it's quite fun. And also in line of the Cousteau King, I'm starting in January. We're starting with a show called the KQL Cafe. So I'm doing that with another MVP, Alex Verboon. And we're doing the show together to get everyone up and running with KQL.
Awesome. So yeah, make sure that you drop the link and we will share it for you.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
Yeah, no problem. And Jeroen, another question for you. You are lead research and development for Wortel Security, is that right?
That's completely true, yes.
Yeah, so I'm mainly interested in the development or in the development part, like what kind of developments are coming up, the ones that we should keep an eye out, you think?
So we are having the SOC as a service at Wortel, the managed detection and response. And the development part is mainly the development of the software that we use to run our SOC. It's called Videra, which once started as a... when we started our SOC with the first customers, we had a big problem. We were not able to see all the incident and things that are happening at our customers. So we started creating our own software, Videra. So we had a single pane of view of all the incident of things that are happening in the environment of our customers. Yeah, that is still growing, that piece of software. So our whole incident response process is modeled around Videra. So it's pretty big nowadays.
So that's the development part. I see now. Okay, yeah. Cool. Well, tonight you will do a session about running a SOC in Azure. And I'm really looking forward to it. So if you're ready, let's go.
Yes, we are ready. So how to run a SOC like Azure Ninjas. Today we are your Azure Ninjas. And let's start with introducing ourselves. You first, Johnny.
Awesome. So we had already a bit of introduction, but I'm Johnny Castaldi. I'm a ninja cat at Wortel, which means I do everything security related. And I'll do consultancy, but also support and also supporting our MDR service. And then the second line is a whole lot of words, which means I'm an MVP since back April. By contributing to the community through my blog, through other sessions, And then I'm I have the GCFE certification, which means I'm a forensic engineer. And Custo King, and I'll be hosting the KQL Cafe starting in January. And I'm also available on Twitter at @CastelloJohnny. And there I tweet a lot about KQL or on the security products of Microsoft.
Okay, so my name is Jeroen Niese. I work as lead research and development at Wortel, which basically means that on a daily basis, I build on our SOC, both from a technical but also a commercial perspective. You might recognize me. I have a YouTube channel called Azure Vlog. In my free time, I like to work with video editing and creating videos and also playing around with Azure. So I try to combine those activities in my my YouTube channel. And if you have any questions security related or the things that we are going to tell you about today, you can reach me on Twitter. At Jeroenis is the Twitter handle. It might be that I'm talking a lot developerish. I have a development background and I grow into the IT pro infrastructure. So sorry for that if I'm talking too much developerish. So today we are going to tell you how you can build the technology to build a cybersecurity center in Azure. So we're going to have a look at Azure Sentinel, and we are going to dive into how you can collect data into it, how you can detect anomalies and things in it, how you can investigate incidents that are detected earlier, and how to respond on those incidents. So what is a cybersecurity center? It is a facility that is responsible for monitoring and analyzing an organization's security posture in a continuous way. So when we look at the security posture of an organization, you can divide all the activities that we do in three categories: the protect category, the detect category, and the respond category. In the protect category, you can put all activities that prevents an attacker from attacking your environment. So think of applying firewall rules, have a virus scanner in place, make sure that your accounts are protected with good passwords, etc. In the detection category, you can define all the activities to detect an attacker from attacking your environment. So detect anomalies on logs, etc. In the last category, the respond category, we respond on those attacks. So we disable accounts, we reset passwords, etc. And when we have a look at a security operations center, we mainly focus around the last two topics, the detect and the respond category. So what is in a cybersecurity center? Well, first of all, people, and they are really important. I can tell you, Johnny, you were once, was one of those people.
Yes, it's mainly because you need to analyze events to make sure that you convert the right items into alerts. And also once you have an alert, there's always a piece where a human has to see if it's something important, or maybe it's a false positive or a true positive. So the triaging of important alerts will most of the times be done by humans. So yeah. The people.
Yeah, so we have a couple of processes in place, a classification process to classify our incidents. We have a triage process in place to triage an incident to determine if it is a true positive or a false positive. We have a prioritization process in place. So when a lot of incidents are happening, we can prioritize on what incidents we need to focus first. An analysis process to investigate what really happened during that incident. And we have a remediation process in place to fix all the damage that has been done by the attack. And lastly, there is also always a audit process to make sure that we are following the right processes. aside from those processes, we have a broad range of tools available for us. A asset discovery system to discover all the assets which might be which fall under our scope. A vulnerability assessment tool to check for vulnerabilities on the assets. An intrusion detection system, behavioral monitoring, and a SIEM. And this session, we are going to focus mainly on the SIEM, the Security Information Event Management System. It's a whole lot of words. So what is it about? So it's about collecting data, mainly logging data that is in the environment, for example, your Azure Activity Logs or your Azure AD Sign-In logs. We want to analyze that data and detect anomalies in it. And when an anomaly is detected, we want to raise an alert or an incident, which we are going to investigate. And depending on our investigation, we might need to take remediation actions, meaning we need to respond on it. So the people that are in a SOC, I have a table over here which describes them. We have a security analyst tier one, which his task is basically reviewing alerts, determine the relevancy of the alert, and potentially convert an alert into an incident. We have a security analyst tier two, and his job is to identify the scope of attack, remediate or recover the environment, and collect asset data, which later can be used for the security expert to do a further investigation. Security expert also does vulnerability management, and he builds response plan for all known threats. Lastly, we have the SOC manager, and his role is to execute crisis communication and making sure that the SOC follows the right processes. So earlier on, I showed that there was an audit process in place in the Security Operations Center, while the SOC manager is responsible for that process. So when we look at the response path of an incident, well, the first time an alert comes in, we need to classify and triage it. We can do that manually. The next step is to prioritize it and analyze it. That could also be a manual activity, as it is a new incident. We haven't seen it before. It's new for us. Next up, we are going to remediate it. So we put remediation actions in place, disable accounts, isolate machines, and even execute recovery actions. So replacing or recovering from a backup. And lastly, we need to audit the process that we followed. But the next time an incident comes in, I would not recommend to do it manually. I would recommend to do it automatically. And luckily for us, Azure has all the tools and capabilities available to do that, to help us with that. So earlier on, I talked about the SIEM, which we are going to tell a lot about today, which is Azure of Microsoft Sentinel, since Ignite it's renamed. So Microsoft Sentinel, and it's Microsoft's cloud native SIEM, which means that we don't have any scaling issues. We have limitless of speed, but I think the scaling issues are the no scaling issues is one of the best features available, because back in the early days, you had the on-premise boxes, and we need to calculate on forehand how many data we are going to ingest, how many hard drives we need, and that was a whole difficult process. Well, nowadays, with Azure Sentinel, we can use the cloud for that, which brings us no scaling issues. And even if we have a really, really, really big bunch of data in it, it's still fast, so that's great. And with Azure Sentinel, we can collect data through connectors, built-in connectors, agents, and there is also an API that we can use. aside from collecting data and generating alerts, there's also a possibility to create dashboards on data that you ingest into Azure Sentinel. We have analytic rules in it for alert generation, and there are capabilities for threat hunting in it. So let's talk about connectors, Johnny.
Awesome. So as you can see on the slide, there are at the moment 120 connectors, which you can collect data from by default out of the box. So in order for that to work, you have the, for instance, the Microsoft Defender for Cloud connector, which collects the data from the product. And you can also, for instance, upload threat intelligence to the system. And like Rune said, you have several ways because you have the backend data connectors, but you can also use, for instance, syslog or APIs or any input which you
Logstash.
So, yeah. So you can collect all the custom data and then make alerts from it. And also, if you go a bit further, you can use, for instance, an event hub or even Logstash to switch data between a storage account or between the SIEM, so Azure Sentinel, or between Azure Data Explorer. And that way you can differentiate your ingestion price, but also the availability. Because by default, Sentinel goes back like 2 years, and a storage account can go like 100 years, more or less.
Yeah, would you recommend us to ingest all the data available?
No, by design, I would recommend to only ingest the data which you're using use cases for. And then you can collect all the data, put it in a Azure Data Explorer or storage account, and that way you can still hunt over the data and also look back further. Because like I said, storage can have a longer retention than Sentinel. And if you don't have any use cases, or if you don't use it for hunting or for enrichment of your alerts, then you can also store it in a different option.
Yeah, I think that's a really good advice over there. When I look at customers, I see a lot of customers enabling all the connectors and things available, but only enable things that you need for your use cases, because it can be very costly.
Yeah, and depending on your size, if you have like 10 firewalls and you put in all the traffic log, the threat protection logs, the wildfire logs in case of Palo Alto, then you can generate a lot of logs, yeah. But you have to look at it, what you really need.
Yeah. Sometimes I see people also ingesting performance logs. Don't do that.
Yeah, from the Kubernetes environments. And
for example, yes.
So we have the connectors, and one of the connectors is the security events connector. And for the security events, you have three types. You have the Microsoft Monitoring Agent, you have the Azure Monitoring Agent, which is the new Microsoft Monitoring Agents, and you have the Windows Forwarded Events. And those are the ways to, in this case, collect the security events. And also, if you have one instance of Sentinel with 250 PCs, it's can be that you want to use a Microsoft Monitoring Agent while it's still available, because it's an easy way to collect all logs. But if your environment grows bigger, or if you manage multiple customers, you don't want to collect all the logs, all the events. And with the Windows Forwarded Events, that's in preview at the moment. And there you can collect events from a Windows collector on premises. So then you can, from the device, you can select which events you want to forward. And from the forwarded events, the collector, you can put them into Sentinel. And then also another option is the Microsoft 365 Defender. And they are moving all the nice bits and pieces of all the security products to 365 Defender. And from the collector, you can collect the incidents, alerts, but it also has bidirectional syncs, which means when you handle an incident from Sentinel, the Defender part gets updated or even closed if you resolve it in Sentinel. So that's also a nice feature.
I think it also brings the raw data in it, right?
Yeah. True, you can choose to bring in the data, And then, for instance, if you have from the emails the attachments, you can bring in all the attachment info so that if you have like a breach, then you can check in the emails later on who received a special email.
Yeah, does it also upload the content of the email, or is it just the metadata?
It's only the metadata.
Okay.
So I can show you a bit in the demo. So if we go to Sentinel. Now this is my demo tenant. And if we scroll down to data connectors, you can scroll down or choose my connectors. Now here we have the 365 Defender one, and you can see that it can collect all the raw data, and some of these features are in a private preview or available or not yet available. And over here you can see all the tables from the 365 portal are here, and also from the Defender for Office part. So this was the one I was talking about just now. You can ingest all the attachment data, which means that if you later on have a SHA hash, or you have a sender, and even if it's like 90 days or 200 days, and you have the data in Sentinel, you can still see what happened to it, and also the post delivery events. So you can see if an email was sent first to quarantine and the user decided to move it back to the inbox or from junk to the inbox, then you can also have those types of logs. That's also a really nice option. And the good thing is, if you don't have a management platform, you can also connect multiple Sentinel instances through Lighthouse, and you can view all the data and the results in one single pane. So you can manage multiple tenants right from here.
Cool.
But then you don't have the nice automation that we have at the moment. So that's nice, yeah. Features.
Well, what I also think is really fascinating, if you go back to the list of the connectors, that it's not just only Microsoft connectors. It's a really wide range of vendors that are having connectors in there over there. I think I saw Google, Cisco, Palo Alto, a really nice range of connectors. And can you also show us how easy it is to set up such a connector?
Yes, of course. All these connectors are managed by code by Microsoft, so they're on the GitHub page, so you can see a bit what they do. But if you want to enable one, for instance, if you want to play with the Palo Alto, you go to Open Connector page, and over here you have the prerequisites. So do you need special permissions on the workspace? Do you need any other information? Do you need maybe a license? And in this case, the configuration of this type of connector goes through syslog, which means you have to have a Linux machine and you have to have a Ceph collector or syslog collector available. There's also a nice script on how to install it. And then you can send your data to the collector. But also, if you look at the more Azure side of the house, because there you have the backend integrations. So if we go to, for instance, the Azure Firewall, over here you can use the backend collection. In this case, what you do is you set up a policy and you enable the diagnostic settings so that all the firewall logs are sent to the specific use space.
Yeah, it's really amazing. In just a couple of clicks, you can have data flowing into your Azure Sentinel instance.
Yeah, it's really easy to collect the data, and also a lot of data. That's also why we're repeating a bit to think about your data, what you want to collect, and how you want to use the data.
Yeah. So in this demo, you saw how we can collect data by using the built-in Microsoft collectors. Connectors, but there is also a way to use APIs or Logstash or any kind of thing to ingest data into your log analytics workspace. The next step would be to analyze the data and create KQL based alert rules or analytic rules, as they are called in Azure Sentinel. Can you tell us something about that, Johnny?
Yes, of course. So the analytics rules start with KQL, which is an easy to read language. It handles large data sets, so you can easily bring a large amount of data to the play. It's a read only data, so you can you can't modify the source data, which also helps in the speed. That says it's fast.
It's really fast. Yeah.
So and then you have to build a analytic rule, you use KQL, and then you have the options for template query rules. The template query rules are available through the Microsoft GitHub. You're also allowed to upload or commit your own use cases so that they will become available in Azure Sentinel. Then you have the scheduled query rules. Oh, sorry, the template rules are from the source systems. Scheduled query rules are from the GitHub. And then you now also have the near real-time query rules, and you can build those to create your own fast rules. And the difference between the scheduled rules and the near real-time rules is they are faster to ingest. Scheduled rules, they are filtered by time generated, while the near real-time rules come in through the ingestion time. And then the scheduling of a normal rule or scheduled rule is between 5 minutes and 14 days, depending on your use case. And the near real-time rule, you don't have an option to schedule it because it will run every minute.
Cool.
And also the syntax with the normal rules, you have like a full rich scale of all operators and functions. Near real-time rules are just the basic operator sets. You can't do any joins or unions. And also you can have 512 rules in scheduled rules, and you can add 20 near real-time rules. And the data set in workspaces and tables is a lot larger in the scheduled rules than a single workspace or a single table in the near real-time.
Yeah, so near real-time rule can only be applied on a single table in a single workspace.
Yeah, so if you want to monitor your HoneyToken account or special account, or if you have like a really important use case, you can use the near real-time rules, and for the rest you will be using the scheduled rules.
Yeah.
This is a bit of the view. So you have this is like the default view. There are some use cases enabled by default. You have the anomaly detections, but it's a much more fun if we do it on a demo. So let's go back to the tenant. Over here you have the analytic rules. And these are the rules which are by default enabled. So you have the multi-stage attack detection, which is used to be called diffusion rule because it fuses several sources of identity, but also firewalls. There are 122 scenarios nowadays, and they fuse these sources. So we wanted to create a new rule. Then you have the scheduled query rule, the incident creation rule, and the near real-time rule. The incident creation rule, you can select a source. So for instance, Defender for endpoint, and we want to say Defender for endpoint critical. And over here we can, for instance, choose to only get the high criticality alerts. We could use a automation over here, which Jeroen will tell later on about.
Pretty neat stuff.
And then you can, yeah. And then you can review and create your first incident rule. And the same goes by the scheduled query rules. And here you can use KQL demo or any name you like. You can use a description. You can use the MITRE tactics to also correlate it to TTPs so that you can identify attackers later on. And over here, you can do Azure, for instance, Azure Activity Take 10. And this will collect any Azure activity with last 10 rules. And also a new cool feature here is you can test it with current data. So what this does is it will look at the query time and the lookback period, and it will run it 50 times to see how often will it have hit in this specific case. Because what happens if you're running a cybersecurity service and this will hit like 1,000 items a day, then you might want to fine-tune it before the team gets flooded by incidents.
This is a pretty cool feature. Before this was in Azure Sentinel, I always got to the logs part of the Azure Sentinel workspace, where you can just type in the query and see all the data that it it queries. But this is a lot more easy.
Yeah. And you could have created this by hand by setting the now time and then looping it 50 times, but this is way easier.
Yeah, this is a pretty neat feature, pretty helpful.
Yeah, and you also have the entity mapping, so you can add up to 5 entities.
Yeah, why would we use that?
To correlate multiple incidents. So if a user got compromised, if they have been part of a brute force, and if there then is an impossible travel alert, then you know that there was a successful attempt on this account. And you can later on also correlate it with maybe defender alerts or other alerts, and then you can...
And does that have to do with the column names in the Azure Sentinel scheme, that, for instance, at the column of defender for endpoint, the username is called user, and somewhere in the Azure Activity Table, it's called color, so we can map it to a single type of entity, so-called.
Yes. So this is the how do you call it, the how do you call it, the conditional formatting, so to say. So we can over here, if we want to show account data, then we can use, for instance, a full name, because that in Azure AD and in the Sentinel through the MMA agent or the security events can be the same. But you can also use object grids, and that way you can also map items to the same record. And also, cool. If you have like computers, let's see. Host. You have host name, for instance, which you can map several values to. So in this case, we want to use the...
Yeah, that is the column in the table that we are querying.
Yeah. And that way you can make sure that all the data ends up in the right place. And over here, you can choose between the 5 minutes and the 14 days. Now it gives an error because the frequency is less than the lookback period or the search period. So if we change it,
can you explain that a little bit? Did a little bit further the interval and the lookback period?
Yeah,
but I see a lot of people making mistakes over there.
Yeah, so the run query every you want, or you want to use 5 minutes or like an hour, because then you get a fast amount. Sometimes you can also use a day, but in security a day is really long. And then the lookback data is the data you want to use in your query. So for instance, if you want to have a query which looks at the data of an hour, then you want to run it every hour. But there can also be instances where you want to have the data of an hour and then maybe use you run it every 30 minutes so you don't have the overlap.
Okay, so never have a lookback period of 1 hour and a period of, let's say, a day to run that rule, because then we are missing mainly 23 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you do it the other way around, then you run it every hour with data of 24 hours, then you will get the same alert 24 times, because in the data, it gets it 24 times.
And that brings us alert fatigue.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So could you also show the templated rules? Because we now saw a really advanced example of how you can create your own rule. But for a lot of connectors, there are already templated rules available.
Yes. or we have over here the rule templates. That's one part where you can find the alerts. And over here you have the data sources. So what you can also do is if you go back to the data connectors, and then you see, let's bring on the Defender one. There you can see which alerts are related to this specific data connector. So if we go down a bit, so all these alerts are relevant if you bring in the Defender data. You might want to tune them based on your environment, based on your settings, based on your policies. But you can get one of these alerts. Let's see. Okay, so this is a MITRE execution credential access, severity high. This is the rule logic, so it looks at file names and hashes.
So the rule logic is open. We can see it. We can alter it.
Yes. In this case, you also need to bring in this specific data. For instance, the device process events is a table from the M365 Defender. So you need to collect it from the connector.
Oh, that's a good tip. So not all templated rules work out of the box. Sometimes you need to alter the rule logic to make them work.
Yeah, or bringing data.
Yeah, makes sense.
So and you have to review the rule. You can check the mapping. So over here, they used the legacy template still. So host, custom entity, account, custom entity are names in the old template, in old entity space. Let's go down a bit more. In this case, it runs every 6 hours. I usually tend to change these types of alerts to 1 hour because if a IP or a SHA hash is hit, you get an alert after 6 hours, it wouldn't be that nice, but that's personal flavor. And then you can have all the grouping, automation, and then over here you can review your alert. So the title says it looks at the hashes related to dev 0228. So this is the query, and it will now run every hour. That's it. So we've now created a basic detection. If we go back to analytics, to active rules, then you can see it over here. And also when it was last modified, which also is sometimes nice.
And yeah. Are these templated rules, are those the same rules that we can find in the GitHub repo
yes.
from Microsoft?
Yes, that's correct. And also, if you see that you're maybe missing a file name over here, you can also push it to the GitHub. And then you can also commit it, and then it will get updated here. And also, what they've done recently is they've added the version numbers. So if you go to GitHub Microsoft Sentinel Detections.
Yeah, what I think is really amazing is that they nowadays have this open community so that we as defenders can work together to protect our environments instead of it's just a single business activity. Because as long as all the attackers work together, I think we as protectors should also be doing that.
Yeah, and also everyone has his own specialty. So if you're really good at creating detections for sign-in logs or security events, then share them, and then people can also use it.
Yeah. So here in the GitHub repo, if you can show it. Yes, there it is.
So over here you have the ID, and the ID is the way that it gets linked to the templates in Sentinel. And you have the description, which connectors are required, the period and the frequency, so how many data are you using. Over here you have the query itself, and then below here you have the version number. And what this does is if you update the version number to 102, then Sentinel will also show, hey, there's a new update for this query, and then you can review it and update it.
Yeah, I haven't played around with the Azure Sentinel PowerShell module that that Microsoft created, but can we use that PowerShell module to import these kind of rules?
Yes, definitely. We do that for our own customers. We have use the module in combination with a library where we import all the detections, and we do that based on a config file. So every customer has its own config, which connector should be enabled, which workspace settings are there, and then you can also automatically deploy that.
Yeah. So if you run a security operations center, really Ninja Cat style, just put all those rules in a Git repo and create a pipeline to deploy all those rules by using the PowerShell module.
It's also nice because over here you have the query, and if you, for instance, besides event ID 18, you might want to use event ID 17. They're both related to named pipes, and then you might want to make sure that it gets updated at 10, 20, 50, 100 customers. So you really want to do it by code.
Makes sense. And with by doing it in code, we also have version control with Git. So it would also be interesting to know exactly what has changed from version to version.
Yes.
So we earlier saw how we can collect data by using the built-in collectors in Azure Sentinel, or use Logstash or the API of anything you like. We now saw how we can detect anomalies and things in our data by using scheduled rules, near real-time rules, templated rules, rules on GitHub, a lot of varieties to create and build your KQL-based rules. Let's now talk about the investigate part. The beauty of Azure Sentinel is that it's a complete solution. So there is a little small incident management system in it. So let me show that to you. So if I go over here in Azure Sentinel, in the menu, you have a thing called incidents. And here I have one incident available. It quickly shows that it's an unassigned incident with the status new, and it has an informational severity. It also has a description, so I know exactly what happened over there. If I click on view full details, I get to see the whole incident. I think that the best view to have a look at my incident is by clicking on the investigate button over here. That brings us to the investigation experience of Azure Sentinel. And earlier on, we were talking about entities, and all those white circles over here, these are entities. So if we map them good in our detection rule, they will end up in our investigation experience over here, which is really nice. I can even click on them. I see a lot of more details about them. This is a really neat thing to have. I can see other incidents on which it mapped. So this really helps me in resolving my incidents and know exactly what happened as part of my incident. But let's go back to the incident. I can quickly assign it to myself. Here I am, assigned to me. Assigned to me. I had to click on the apply button over here. I can change the status to let the other people that are working in our SOC know that I'm busy with it by changing it to active. And you know what? I don't think this is an informational incident. I think it's a low priority, a little bit more important. So now I can work on this incident. People know it. And once I'm done with the incident, I can change the status over here to closed. I can set up the triage reason. True positive, suspicious activity, when I think this really was an attack and I need to apply mitigation activities. Benign positive, when I think this really happened, but it's not that important. We can leave it for now. It's not a direct threat. False positive, based on incorrect alert logic. If I click this one, I think I had to go back to the analytics rule and change my rule logic over there. A false positive due to inaccurate data or indetermined. Well, I think this one is a benign positive. It's okay that this happened, but it's not a direct threat. So this is a really, really, really simple incident management system, but for a small company, this can do the job. So I have a timeline over here, which shows also the timeline of my incident. I can view all the entities over here. I can even have a discussion with my team over here. So we can discuss about this incident. It's really small, but neat incident management system that we have over here. So let's go back to the presentation. Now you saw how we collect data using the data connectors. You saw how we collect data with the data connectors. You saw how we detect anomalies and threats by using the KQL queries, scheduled or templated rules. You saw how we investigated an incident with the small little incident management system that is in Azure Sentinel. But now let's talk about how we can respond on incidents, because Azure Sentinel has built-in features for that. So within Azure Sentinel, we have a thing called automation rules. And this makes Azure Sentinel a real SOAR system. It can help us by enriching both the alerts and incidents, but you can also use it to trigger logic apps. A workflow that we can use to resolve our incident. I will show that in a minute. So logic apps, it's basically a control flow to execute the automated response of incidents. And it can be used both from an incident directly or through the automation rules. And they are basically drag and drop. So you don't need to be a programmer or developer in order to build this kind of automation. If you can use the mouse, you can build a logic app. So let me show you how all those things are working in Azure Sentinel. So if we go back to Azure Sentinel, and we have our manual over here. We have a menu item called automation. And here we have automation rules. So let's create a new automation rule. I can give it a name. Let's say raise the severity. And it has a trigger. And this automation rule triggers when an incident is created. So as soon as the incident is created, the logic, when it meets the conditions that we are defined in the moment, it will apply the logic that we define over here. So I can apply some conditions over here. So I can filter out some incidents or include some incidents. In this case, if the name contains, I can click here, new Cloud Shell user, for example, which is the name of one of my incident analytics rules. I can add some actions, logic to alter the incidents. For example, change the severity, and I can change it to high, as it's a really important thing. I can set an expiration date. So for example, I can say only make this available for 3 days. For example, when I have an incident burst or a patch or thing is released, which create a lot of incidents, I can set an expiration date over here to make it only temporarily available. For now, leave it to indefinite. When I click apply, it will save my automation rule. And as soon as an incident comes in with the title new Cloud Shell user, it will raise the severity automatically to high. But there is more. I can also create a playbook almost saying automation rule. Run playbook, I give it a name. Also select a name of one of my instances over here. Let's say Azure updated. And over here, I can say run a playbook. So this will let me run a logic app. So we can do automated response on our incidents. So let's say notify through Slack. I can use my logic apps not only to respond on incidents, but also to make people aware that something is happening. And when I click apply, as soon as an incident comes in with the name Azure updated, it will start my playbook LAPP notify Slack. Well, if I go to my logic apps over here, I click on this Slack logic app. I go to edit. You can see what a logic app is. So we have a trigger, the starting point of our logic app, and then a control flow will follow. In this case, we only have one step, which is the post message through Slack. And this will basically send in my will put a message in my general channel. So when the incident happens, I can see that it is created. I can add other steps. I can even use a condition in here. So if my incident, my incident severity, for example, where is it? It's equal to high. Then I can execute other activities over here. I think there's also something with Teams, I guess so. No Teams. That's too bad.
It should be there somewhere.
Yeah. But I think the concept is clear. Based on this control flow, I can make things happen in my environment. Let me show you another logic app. For example, the auto response to disable a account. When I click on edit, you can see the control flow over here. So this also starts with the trigger when an Azure Sentinel incident is created. I will collect the entities from I will collect the accounts from the list of entities that are part of my incident. And for each account, I will get the user from the Azure AD. And I will execute a REST call to the Graph API to make sure that the property account enabled is set to false. So this basically disables my account.
Yeah, what's also a cool feature, over here we're doing it through the cloud, but also if you have like automation set up and you use the Azure Hybrid Runbook Workers, then you can also put actions on-prem. So you can use, for instance, PowerShell to disable the on-premises accounts.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. So this is our entry point of automatically responding on incidents.
Yeah.
So let me get back to the presentation. So we are nearing the end. So in this presentation, I gave you a quick introduction into a cybersecurity center. We now know what people there are working, what processes there are. And then we started talking about Azure Sentinel. You saw how we can collect data by using the data connectors or the API or Logstash or anything you like to collect logging data. You saw how we can detect threats and anomalies out of that data by using near real-time alert rules or scheduled rules or templated rules. Also, a lot of choice over there. And when such a rule finds data, it will create an alert. You saw how we can investigate an alert like that and respond automatically on an alert of that. So that brings us to the end. Are there any questions?
Hi. Thanks for the talk, guys. It was really nice. Yeah, I have some questions for you. So if you have a few more minutes, then
Yeah, sure, no problem.
All right. So the first one is, well, what kind of alert do you see triggered the most? Like in current day, what kind of hacks or alerts are triggered the most?
I think those are mostly related to the sign-in logs of the Azure AD. Nowadays, the first barrier of defense is authentication. So a lot of things are happening over there. You see password spraying attacks, but also users who are using the wrong password multiple times. That triggers a lot of alerts. How do you think about it, Johnny?
Yeah, identity is one, but also if you look at the endpoints, the things you get to see a lot more are, for instance, HTML smuggling. That's the Edge updates and the Firefox updates, which say, hey, you have an update. And then instead of downloading it, it uses JavaScript to create a file on your system. And then you, so to say, install the update. And because it's created on your systems, you won't see it on your firewalls, on your IDS, IPS, because it's generated on your device. And those types of attacks you get to see a lot nowadays. Back in 2016, there were like several, let's say 50 to 100 a year. And now it's the most used in phishing and also in browser-based attacks. So that's one you really get to see a lot.
Yeah, I can imagine that they're after your identity. But how do you, how do you keep your hunting queries up to date? I mean, they're always inventing new stuff, new hacks. They will always try harder to get in. So how do you keep your, is it like you point your Sentinel to GitHub and you trust in the community, or do you actually build like your own first line of defense?
It's a cat and mouse game, but I think Johnny wants to answer it.
So the thing is, yes, the attackers always find new things, but in the end, the MITRE attack framework is really a nice framework to use. So for instance, account creation is a thing an attacker does often. So you want to monitor account creations on your device, password spraying, credentialed access, destroying of files, even though you're a bit too late, you still want to know if on the system, if there are, let's say 500 to 1,000 files deleted, you know that there's something wrong on the device. So all the facets of an attack, you can create a detection on, and some are in the Sentinel GitHub, and some you want to create by yourself in Sentinel or in Defender or based on whichever tools you're using.
Yeah, well, what we are also doing that is reverse engineering an attack. So most of the time when a customer or a device gets attacked, there are a lot of PowerShell scripts, malware, and we can reverse engineer them. And based on the data and logic that we find in there, we can also create our detection rules.
Okay. And once you build these updated queries, are you also sharing them back with the community?
Yeah, some we did. It's also depending on the type of query, because sometimes you really want to tailor it to a specific customer's environment. So you don't want to share customer data, but we usually tend, for instance, to use a query in combination with a watch list so we can share the query. And also for our customers, we use the watch list to specify account details or host names or whatever you need to make your rule customer specific.
All right. Well, great answers. I guess, Luke, do you have anything to add? Or?
Well, maybe also one question, because when I deploy resources to the Azure environment, are those resources automatically picked up by Sentinel, or do I need to configure them so they are monitored?
Well, there is an Azure connector in Azure Sentinel to connect your Azure subscription. So if your Azure subscription is part of that connector, you can link your subscriptions over there, the activity logs of the deployment will end up in Azure Sentinel. So that does not mean that the resource itself is connected, but the metadata around it, how we create it, is sent over to Azure Sentinel. There is, for most resources, there is the possibility to forward diagnostic logging to Azure Sentinel, but only do that if you are using it for your use cases, because it can be very costly.
There's also, you have to... You can onboard your devices through a policy in the Azure Defender or in the Defender for Endpoint or in the Defender for Cloud. And also, if you spin up a device in Azure, you usually have the Azure Firewall. So you can also onboard your Azure Firewall to Sentinel. So in that case, you can use a lot of policies to automatically onboard your cloud VMs.
Yeah. Okay. Makes sense. Cool. Thanks.
Awesome. Well, I guess that was it for tonight. So thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you very much, guys.
Great session. And I guess we will have a very short break, 2 or 3 minutes, and then we will be moving on towards the next session.
Yeah.
All right. See you in a bit. And we're back.
And we're back again. Yeah, all set. So yeah, let's move on to our next guest. Please welcome Suzanne. Hi. Good evening.
This must be the fastest 2 minutes in my life.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's always good to check if everybody is ready. So that's. But yeah, we were. So we were. Yeah. Yeah. Shortest break ever, probably. Yeah. Yeah. Good to have you. Great to have you. I think we already did quite some things together for the community, but this is the first time that we have you as a speaker at our event, at our Azure Thursday event.
Yeah, finally. It took a little while, right?
Yeah.
No, you never volunteered before.
Yeah, that's true. That's the organizer life, right? Like, you're always running and always trying to figure out what to do next and show up everywhere, and
always busy with organizing and doing stuff, and then but hey, you were here. Great to have you. I saw you started a few months ago a new opportunity at a really nice organization. Did you already have some chance to meet someone in real life, or is it all?
Not at all. And this is so weird. So I joined Spotify a few months back, and when I joined Spotify, I was working from home and like fully remote, and I met some people on my team at my previous employer. Then I switched jobs, but actually I was still in the same room and still not meeting anyone. So that is like one of the most weird experiences I had in my professional career over the past years. It is so unreal to be in this room. And to literally I changed some things around.
The room is the same, but you have completely other.
It's the same room. So it feels a little bit different. And I'm doing all kinds of exciting stuff. I will tell more about that later. But and that's like super cool. But it's still 2020, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, great. Yeah, you will give us an introduction into Backsys. I need to admit, I don't know. I've never heard of it before, so I'm really.
Let's change that. Session. Let's change
yeah,
that.
Yeah. So yeah.
Yeah.
I would say just take it away and have fun.
And still, you invited me. So
yeah.
Like,
of course.
You know, so
yeah.
Next time I will make up a surface and see. Like no. Let's not push it. Let me gently share my screen. There you go. This should be all right, right? I see my screen. Good. So, it's always a joy presenting virtually. Always juggling screens and that sort of stuff. But this all looks good. So, hi, folks. I'm really happy to finally be speaking at Azure First Day. So that is really cool. I'm Susanne Daniels. I work in developer relations at Spotify. And I do not work for the music service. I work for an open source developer platform. So tonight I will cover how we came to build the developer portal and how it's now at the core of the developer experience at Spotify and how we came to open source it. And we'll have a brief peek behind the curtain. Ha. And yeah, maybe it's a bit odd, like a music company launching a best-in-class developer portal. Yes, we did that. A lot has been written about the engineering culture at Spotify, how we are organized, how we work in an agile way on whatnot, how we have this autonomous engineering culture. And we have always believed in the advantages coming from that. From that autonomous culture. But there's also challenges. There's also a downside. And that brings me to the story where we came from and how we ended up here. So a bit over a decade ago, the whole engineering team could basically fit in a big car. And Spotify was basically built on top of monoliths, which lived on servers. And those servers had names, and people like to hug their servers or give them names and that sort of stuff. And the way it was managed basically could be done with spreadsheets. And actually, that was the case. And there was some tooling introduced to manage the spreadsheets or the data, getting in the data, getting out the data, making sure everything the people needed in the data center was in order. So they could do their work properly and automate stuff. But over the years, this team grew. And it grew to the size of this small village. And there was also a move to microservices. The infrastructure grew. Everything was more complex. So if this happens, and if you grow, it becomes difficult to keep track on who owns which microservice, who's running on call for something, where can I find information? So a solution was created, and like many good stories start, there was a tool introduced. And a tool that was called ServiceDB, and that had a database, and people could go search for services and find some information about that. And that solved it a little bit. But the growth continued. And the infrastructure became more and more complex because of new technologies. Technologies became more complex, evolved faster. Finding stuff was really hard, especially when you did not have the knowledge, the tribal knowledge, to find that information. So if you were new and onboarding at a company, at Spotify at that time, it was hard to get on board. It was hard to find information. It was hard to move outside of your specific domain. So let's skip to the year 2016. Back and forth. But the year 2016, and Spotify accelerated in hypergrowth. But the onboarding became more and more confusing to a point where it was hyper confusing, right? The internal fragmentation, it slowed the teams down, but everybody wanted to get more speed. Adding more engineers to your teams at some point, it just not improves your velocity at all. It actually slows you down. And with all the technologies exploding, multiple platforms, versions of frameworks, everything together used by different teams, which grow exponentially, that's pure chaos. Now, one of the ways we measured our onboarding of developers was to look at the number of days it would take an engineer to get to the 10th pull request. And at some point, that went up to 60 days to get to your 10th pull request. So we knew we needed to solve this. So we had this team, and that team created a portal, a developer portal. And it was called System Z. And that was one place where people could find stuff. Who owns the service? Who's running on call? If you would log in, you would immediately see what you, and by you, I mean your team, own. You could immediately discover and search stuff. That was a great success. There is, however, one thing we learned, a little fault in here. And if you paid attention, you hear me say there was one team who created this portal. And that was a problem because everybody loved the portal and they wanted to get going with it. But can you imagine one team being responsible for all the feature requests and issues for that one portal? So just imagine their backlog. And the system was not made for extensibility. It was hard for people to contribute. So that needed to be solved as well. So we needed to fix that again. We reworked this System Z, and it got a plugin framework. And with this plugin framework, teams with specific domain knowledge could create plugins in an isolated way. They could create their plugin and they could put it on top of Backstage. And they were able to actually tackle their problems to get their stuff in. Because if you are not able to do that, then you will eventually have fragmentation, because if you can't solve it in the tool, you will go outside of the tool. You will find your own solutions, because those are all autonomous teams. They all want speed. They all want their problem solved. So this was a more better approach, which made much more sense and resonated really good within our developer community. Now, that was not the only thing. Also, the catalog was extended to host more types, like websites or data pipelines. And it got a rebranding and we renamed it to Backstage, which is conveniently also the name for the open source project. So this is what we have nowadays. We have this developer portal and everything you need is in there and is searchable. You can manage your services, you can explore your services, and you can create your service only from this one portal. And no, this portal doesn't solve everything. It doesn't do a lot. It aggregates the information and it makes sure that it is visible in one interface instead of going to 13 portals to do one mundane task or learn specific CLI commands for each tool or each tool in each domain, because everybody has this little other way of implementing stuff. And this new approach really hit the note. And over 80% of the contributions to Backstage come outside of the core team. Over 150 plugins have been contributed. And eventually, the number of days to get to that 10th PR, not overnight, but it eventually went down to 20. But that doesn't really say much about happiness. And to measure that, if people are satisfied, we have this internal engineering survey where each and every tool gets rated by engineering people. And they can rate the services, and Backstage scores 86%. And that is really, really good. And we're really happy with that. And it shows that this approach really was a success. So a lot of companies asked us, hey, what is that thing that you use there? Can we maybe get our hands on that? And in March 2020, during our hack week, we actually open sourced it. And that's not the only reason to open source it. It's also because Backstage is at the core of our engineering experience. And to keep it successful, and to ensure a good future for Backstage, open sourcing really was the way to go. We get a better product, collaborating with other people, with other perspectives, other businesses, other skill sets. That's the way forward for this product. So since open sourcing it, a lot has happened. One of the things is that it's actually donated to the CNCF. It's now a CNCF sandbox project, and that also had a great result. We have a really thriving community around Backstage, which is growing and growing. Last week, we had contributor number 500 contributing, so that's really, really great news. We had a little party behind the scenes. But also the returning contributors are growing steadily. So more and more people who do their first time contribution, they do come back. And that's, of course, really important. And we have very, very fun and well-visited community meetups. Obviously, all digital. I'll share the link later. Yeah, and companies are adopting Backstage. We have over 70 adopters. There are some logos there. Yeah, these are the companies. And this is really important for such an open source project, because companies betting on Backstage is good for Backstage. We are ensured that people are spending time to develop their plugins, to improve the product for themselves. Some contribute back to the community. It improves the product. And that's a great story. And that's how we like it. So Backstage is a platform. I know I've used developer portal and platform, but it is essentially a platform. And by that, I mean that in itself, Backstage does not solve a lot. The plugins are the power behind Backstage. So you extend Backstage, and by that, you make a developer portal. So just see it as the bottom plate of a Lego set. You know, you have to build on top of that yourself. And that is basically the success at Spotify. And it can also be the success at your company. It is more than an intranet for developers. I've read somebody like, well, developer portal, that's just a wiki. Well, no, it is also not a wiki. It is one front end for your entire infrastructure to integrate your tooling, like your CI/CD, your Kubernetes monitoring, security tools like Snyk testing. Your services service catalog, applications, data, and your documentation for your components, like your APIs, but also other things like org charts or strategy documentation. And that you put on one place, regardless of how or where individual components are running or who manages them. So you have all these single sources of truth, and you have this one place where you aggregate them. Because let's be honest, when you would be onboarding at this super hip and happening company as an engineer, and you come back the first day, you get the question, hey, how was your day? Well, my first day was really good. I have sent 8 Slack messages. I have found out that 3 of the teams actually renamed themselves to Marvel characters. And this person who's called Jim, nobody knows in which team he is, but we do know he's there tomorrow. Okay, day 2. Awesome. I found this Jim person, and he sent me this Excel file. I am now finding out what is the password to unlock it. It should be on the wiki somewhere. Day 3. Well, I was at the coffee machine. It begins with yes. And I was complaining, and I got to talk to somebody, and that was a senior engineer called Irma, and she pointed me to this repository, and she said, yeah, well, I always clone this project to make sure that everything is according to the latest standards. Okay. But this also goes when you work longer somewhere for a longer period, like, oh, I've opened 3 portals to have my skeleton app ready. I learned yet another cloud provider portal. Oh, let me take that back. This cloud provider, it's not really that consistent. So I have to learn every single service again. Oh, the docs for my microservice, I'm no longer working on. That needs to be migrated to another doc system again. So these are all examples of frustrating experiences which create friction. And these are not the things we want to be working on. Probably you, if you are at work, you want to write code, or you want to implement something, or you want to look at some reporting or security stuff. You do not want to look at spreadsheets. You do not want an Excel file. You would want to maybe burn all the Excel files, but you would have to print them first, which is not a good idea. So Backstage lets you create new software using software templates. It will let you manage all the software you own in one centralized location. You are able to explore everything you need to get your job done. Libraries, maybe the dependencies, the infrastructure it relates to or depends on. But also, who do I need to call in the middle of the night if this service breaks down? So enough with the talking. Let's take a look at what it actually is. I'm going to try and open a browser. There you go. Okay, so I am this engineer, and I just got onboarded at this new company, which is called the Imaginary Goats Company, which happens to be the squad name I'm in. But yeah, I thought it was funny with the logo thingy here. Like, okay. Anyways, so I just got onboarded, and during my onboarding conversations, people pointed me like to this tool called Backstage, and they said, well, basically everything we have in this company, you can find it in that one place. Your onboarding document, how you will learn to use different technologies, how you can deploy stuff, how we do the documentation, what to find, where, what portals to look at. That's all also in this system. So during my onboarding, I already got a little bit used to the interface, and now I'm done. And I'm like, okay, well, let's try and deploy my first microservice. But first, let me just find out what this actually is, because that's basically the first thing I would want to discover is, okay, let's see what this company has. What kind of services do we have? If there is this service I would want to look into, I could, for instance, look at a certain team. Maybe DevRel, which happens to be the team I'm in. Certain lifecycle, I can filter this, I can filter specific types. And when I found what I need, I can click on that and can look at this service and look at the details. Now, this is like the homepage of my service. And here I can like see who owns it, what is the lifecycle. I can see who's running on call. Well, surprise, I just onboarded and I'm already on call for 3 years, according to PagerDuty, so I'm happy. Here's some the index, .md, and the relationship which the service has. So this is a service my team manages. I do not know a lot of stuff about that, but I can here immediately see that this consumes the Spotify API. So I could discover that, or I can like look at the whole graph and maybe go wild with that and find out what I need to know and just clicking away what I don't need. But also I can look at what is the CI/CD status. How, well, this is not really good. Let me just rerun the workflow. These are all things I can do right from this portal, just by clicking on the service, and I can discover everything. Looking at the APIs, well, this is the API it consumes. Well, maybe I just want to look at the documentation for this API. I want to find out how I can get the albums. And here I can basically find all the documentation I need to get started here. But yeah, let's go back to the service. So I can also go to GitHub and I can see that there's this workshop I created at some point. And there's the documentation itself. Now this is obviously all Markdown and it works like you would expect. And I can just go through the documentation. And this was also the way I onboarded when I joined Spotify. There were these golden paths. You're in engineering, you're an engineer. Here's the golden path for engineering, for backend or frontend, or maybe for a data engineer. So that's a way I onboarded, but also if there's a service and the service has documentation, I can find it also in this one place, which is really, really a good experience. Now, I've clicked a lot and I've read a lot and I now understand what I need to do. I have seen how others have done it. I've seen that a lot of stuff is arranged under the hood for me. And I learned that I am able to create an application also from Backstage. And I told you earlier about, you know, if you are at this company and you want to get started and you want to get started real quick, we can gossip together. It's just between us. The fastest way could be that you would like clone an existing project and you yank everything out you don't need and you build your application on top of that. Or maybe you have to find all kinds of stuff here and there and go through a few tutorials. Maybe you've automated a lot of stuff, but then you still need to add the documentation somewhere, register it in the system, maybe do some manual work or go to another portal again. So for this, Backstage has software templates, and that's the scaffolder service. And with the scaffolder service, you can deploy your template according to the standards you, your team, your company sets, and it will create everything for you. So it will create your skeleton application. It will register it in Backstage and whatnot. Even the documentation should be there. So let's try it. Let's say we are really confident and we name it Azure. I can't even type. There we go. So description, the owner, well, that's my team, because eventually we think that a team always owns something and not a single person. So I press next, I choose a location. Well, this company hosts everything on GitHub, and there should be a name for the repository and an owner. And there we go. I can review, is this the thing I would want to create? I press create, and now it fetches the skeleton, it populates it with the data from the form I just filled out. It will do everything I need, creating the skeleton app, making sure that there's documentation in there, that it lives up to the standard of my company. And, you know, for instance, policies change. I don't even need to know about that because it would be in there. Well, it's done. Let's see if my newly created service is here. And yes, it is there. So now I'm confident that I have done the right thing. It is there. I can see that even like the documentation is being generated. Probably it will say it's busy. Yeah. And as you can see, everything I need for my company is here. You might have been wondering, like hey, how does that stuff actually get into Backstage? Well, I'm sorry, it's YAML. But as you can see, I didn't have to do any YAML because it was auto-generated by the template. So that's maybe like the upside here. And this is also the way I can extend it. So this uses the Kubernetes object model. Let me click this. There you go. So for instance, if I would want to extend this, like the other service we looked at earlier with PagerDuty, then I would just add in the annotations PagerDuty, and I would add my key, which I will not do because I know you are all way too smart. Oh yeah, the other thing I wanted to point out as well is that where does the documentation come from? Well, obviously it sits with the source code because it should be a part of your process, and it's generated here. So. How does it find that? Well, you can see that we use mkdocs, and here's the configuration for that. This is just an example, of course, but you can go well creative with that. Ah, look, there's the documentation. Good. So the other thing I would do is manage. And managing my stuff is looking at CI/CD of my newly created service. But there's like tons of plugins for Backstage. Actually, let's just take a look at that. There you go. So as you can see, there's various things available for you. And these are all NPM packages, so you can relatively easy, I should say, or streamlined, install them into your Backstage environment. If you're like, oh, well, I use Argo, well, please, Argo CD, here's the plugin. You can find some documentation on how to implement that. And this is the way you actually extend Backstage. Okay, that was a brief look at Backstage. Have I forgotten anything? No, I think not. Oh yeah, this is the Tech Radar, which is a way to see which services I should not yet and should use. So that's also one of the functionalities. There's also like a cost insights, so you can keep track of your cost management. That's also a really neat functionality. But I do not have a cloud provider configured just yet. So imagine what you could put in there. And it being all YAML, you could like link it to your cloud services, maybe, like on which surface does my microservice run on? So the possibilities are kind of endless and up to your imagination. So this is the interface. It is not your single point of truth. It is the single pane of glass. Autonomy is one of the most important things for a Backstage. One team managing everything is really hard. With all the plugins, if you look at our core team, it is like about 6 people who manage Backstage. And the reason they can do that is because the teams with the domain knowledge, they create the plugins and they're responsible for the plugin. And that way it is all decentralized, just like our teams, it's autonomous. And the ownership, each component there is always has one owner, and that owner is responsible for that service. Responsible for the metadata in there. It is responsible for the production status. And usually this should be a team. So no, this is not the tool which will solve everything. But it is a great way to build up on your developer experience. So the software model has some core entities, like there may be a domain, there may be a system. The system may have the components and may leverage an API. There's of course users and there's groups, but each of these entities can also have a lot of different types. And that all is owned by somebody or is a member of something. So there's also a great level of detail you can bring in there for relationships. And to extend this, you use annotations. So like I show in my example with PagerDuty, that is an annotation I use for the PagerDuty plugin I installed. And that way, I can extend it. One of the other things is, like for GitHub, the GitHub slug, project slug, is also in there. This is an example of the catalog info.yaml. This lives with the source code. It uses the Kubernetes object model. It is extensible. But it's also optional. There are other ways to ingest information. You can, for instance, use a custom processor. The software templates, I've shown you how you can use them to deploy. This is the way you can ensure that the best practices are in there. That's a streamlined experience. And you can basically know what to expect. But it also registers it in the catalog. And well, one of the benefits is, of course, you do not have to write YAML. I cannot stress this enough. Now you might wonder, okay, this is all cool, but now I have these existing services because, well, this is really a happy, happy flow. So let's take another look. If I can find my browser again. So if I go to create and I register an existing component, I have placed this this YAML file inside my repo, and now I'm able to just edit. I can analyze it, it will look at the file, if it's okay, it will show the details of that, and I can import that. It will read it, and it will do basically the things to register this in my portal. The rest is not there yet. If you look at the YAML file itself, oh, that's good. Why? Ah, there you go. There you go. So this is the place where I then would start start expanding that. Okay. Yep. Please be gone. There you go. So that was the thing about plugins. Yes. Good. I lost my browser there for a minute and my presentation, but it's all back now. So the other thing is it has this customizable, extensible plugin architecture. This is TypeScript, JavaScript in an NPM bundle with a backstage prefix. You can also start of creating a plugin from a skeleton plugin with yarn create plugin on the command line. And all core functionality basically is also just plugins. So everything I've shown you is basically also a plugin. So there's this core functionality making up backstage, but everything I actually use as an engineer, those are all plugins. So this will address a lot of different challenges you might face. One of them is that we all will have a lot more new colleagues probably in the coming next years. So there's a lot of new onboarding. The ecosystem gets more and more chaotic. New versions coming out more rapidly. If you use a framework, new frameworks are coming out more rapidly. New versions of frameworks. It's becoming really complex. So, and the other thing is that it is open source. And that basically is also a really good thing, because you are able to leverage the power of a community looking at stuff, companies developing stuff in-house and open sourcing that. But you can also get in contact with other people. You can be a part of a thriving, fun community, if I might say that. Join our meetup at December 15, for instance. You can see for yourself. We have adopters sharing knowledge with each other. We also have from Spotify, you can schedule a call with us, and we like have these conversations every day with companies who are like interested in finding out how they can like do the adoption or where to get started with DX or that sort of questions. So if you look at backstage, a small team should manage it. The platform teams, they build, they maintain, they're the experts, right? So they own the plugins. And the feature teams, they use the plugins and they build and they maintain their software. But more importantly, what you see is if you do that, you have this ownership and you have this feedback loop. So that really, really works well. So yeah, how do you deploy backstage? Well, basically, you would just use what you normally use, the way you deploy everything else. So one way or another, it will fit in your infrastructure. It should follow the same deployment mechanisms as you have, because otherwise it would be like, would not make sense. And luckily, it is flexible to do that. So you're able to fit it in most places. Okay. That is a really great story, I think. But I have 20 bazillion thousand software components running in production. My docs are scattered around my organization. I have Confluence, I have Google Docs, who knows what else, Excel. And I'm onboarding new engineers like daily. So where to start? And this question really makes sense, because as you can see, it could solve a lot of things. It doesn't mean you should. So focus on one problem you'd like to solve with Backstage, and maybe start with something which has a narrow use case. And then, you know, adding small wins as you go, get to learn a product, get to know the community, learn how to navigate that, how to navigate the project itself. Spread knowledge internally. Have these hackathons where you maybe create a plugin together, and have these knowledge sharing sessions with each other. Show off what you have. Think of a great name. Make it a real like product within your developer community. And that is most of the times the best way to build up this adoption of Backstage and get everybody enthusiastic to contribute to Backstage and to see the value there. So if you want to get started, there are some resources. I will ask someone to paste these in the chat. Like I said, we have a great community. We have community sessions. The next one is December 15th. The link will also be in the chat there. We will have an adopter telling about their journey with Backstage. We'll have a little panel discussion around questions which the community asked. That sort of things. We have the newsletter. There's a lot to explore, and a really lively Discord. So if you have any questions, there's always a way to ask them. And of course, I think my Twitter handle was on the screen earlier. Just find me and I'll be happy to connect you to somebody who can answer a question or answer it myself if I'm able to. That is basically what I wanted to share about Backstage tonight. Are there any questions?
Great. Thanks. Thank you very much. Yes, we have some questions. So one question we have is, can you use other Git providers than GitHub?
Yes. Yeah, there's like a lot of extensions. So if you use GitLab or something, that's totally possible. There's like many different extensions. Also, if you look at the CI/CD, there's also Jenkins, and there's tons of, not tons, but there's a lot of plugins.
Lot.
I can tell you. Yeah, and yeah. I chose GitHub because that is basically what I was working on before the session, is on the getting started documentation. And I chose to go with GitHub. Don't ask why.
Okay, cool. Thanks. Yeah, and I think it's pretty amazing product, and it's awesome potential. And where do you see Backstage in let's say the next 3 years, or where it's going to? Yeah.
Yeah. This is a fairly new category, like internal developer portals. I always believe that if you look at technology, technology itself is really cool. I can talk for hours about technology. Well, you know that. But I can talk for hours about technology. But technology is only really cool if people are able to use it and understand it, and if they can work without friction. And I think it's a good thing that there's more and more attention to having to giving developers a more frictionless experience. More and more companies have internal DX divisions, massively improving the developer experience. We have cloud providers talking about developer effectiveness. So there is a lot of attention for this. I see a lot of companies doing a lot of investment in this area. And it's necessary, because I don't know about you, but it is so chaotic. It is so
agree. Like, yeah, it's a really hot topic. It's especially with at the bigger companies. Then and it's I think it's a must have to have something like this. And yeah, I think it's like a CMDB, but then the next level.
The fun thing is when I learned off tech stage first, I was thinking back of the moment when I was consultant for many, many years, and I have put together a developer portal so many times, but it was all like gluing together this stuff. And I can only imagine how it would have benefited me if I had this 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Like it is so challenging if your focus is on developer platforms and creating a good developer experience, doing this automation. The success is really adoption. That is what it depends on, because it needs to be easy to use. People need to understand what they're doing. They do not want to learn a lot of new stuff or switch context all the time. So this basically addresses all those things. So I'm really impressed. And if you ask, where is this going? I expect a lot more plugins. I think that every time I talk to a company who adopted Backstage, there's always something in the works somewhere. There's also a growing interest in certain plugins. If you look at stuff like supporting various tooling, or maybe even infrastructure at some point. There's a lot of interest there. So I see that growing as well. And I don't want to predict anything, but this is already a huge thing. And if you look at the adopters, like 70 plus companies, there's also a lot of really, really, really large companies who are not on the list because they don't do that. That's like really it's really energizing to see what happens there and see all the contributions trickling in. The future is in the hands of the person who used this.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Yeah. Thanks. Well, I'm out of questions, Jorrit. I don't know if you have any left.
No, it was a really clear story. Yeah. Kimmy. Thanks.
Yeah, and I'm happy I was able to continue because my screen went dark suddenly.
Yeah.
What happened here? Stress level. I did not miss the remote remote session.
Yeah, that's good. I don't think we saw it during the session, so that was good.
Yeah. Otherwise, cut out the face line.
Yeah.
What?
Okay.
So
well,
thank you, so
thank
much
you very
for,
much
for having me.
Yeah. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for being here. And we'll see you around.
Yes. Thank you. And I will paste the links in the chat, of course.
Yeah. If you send us the information, then we can also share it at our channels.
All right. Cool. Well, I guess that's it for tonight.
Yeah, it was a great evening, I think.
Yeah, I would say. So hopefully, probably the next one will also be online only.
It's not decided yet. If we can do it in person, but yeah, I don't think the chances are very high to do it. Another way, we will at least be online. There will be an Azure Thursday in January. Awesome. Not in the first week as normal, but in the second week.
Due to the holidays.
Yeah.
All right. Well, all right. I guess we will see everybody then.
I hope so. Thanks, okay. All. See you next time.
Have a great evening.
Bye-bye.